The expanding universe. Now, all the way back in the 1700s, some people began to question the idea that the universe was eternal and that stars were eternal and the universe went on forever and so forth. And there's one particular example where this guy Olber suggests, look, if there were an infinite number of stars and an infinite, you know, infinitely far distance, that everywhere you looked in the sky, it would be bright. You would always see a star no matter where you looked, kind of like trying to look through a forest of very thin trees. No matter how thin the trees are, if it's an infinite forest, your eyesight will always hit a tree in some direction. So just in that logical sense, he began suggesting that maybe the universe was finite all the way back in the 1700s. But let's get up to where the story really starts to take shape here. In the early 1900s, we're actually going to start with a man named Vesto Slipher, who was using the Doppler shift, which had been around for maybe, I'd say, about 50 years at that point. And what he discovered, looking at these smudges, these island universes, as they were called, he looked at galaxies and found out that almost all of them were red-shifted. They were moving away from us. Now, at the time, everybody knew that was significant, but they couldn't quite put it together. They couldn't quite understand. The only ones that weren't redshifted, by the way, were galaxies that were pretty close to us, like the Andromeda Galaxy, which, of course, is coming towards us and is therefore blue-shifted. But the man who put it together was the same man, Edwin Hubble, who first measured the distance to other galaxies and realized that these other these smudges, what they called spiral nebulae and things, were actually apart from our Milky Way. They were separate galaxies. And he measured the distance to Andromeda using the Cepheid variable stars, those blinking stars, in 1923. But he had an even bigger discovery ahead of him later in the 1920s, Hubble's Law. Now, what Hubble did, now that he could use Cepheid variables to measure distances, he began to compare Vesto Slipher's velocities. Remember, the Doppler effect is like a radar gun for the universe. That tells us velocity. And he compared the velocities and the distances and found out that they were directly proportional to each other. And so you end up with this really simple equation. The velocity is equal to, that's called H naught, or Hubble's constant, times the distance. Now, H naught, as the name implies, is a constant. It's the same number, and we're always trying to fine-tune and find out exactly what that number is. But the fact remains, if you make D larger, V gets larger. They're directly proportional. So, for example, a galaxy that is twice as far away, if D is twice as much, its velocity then will be twice as great away from us. Its recessional velocity will be twice as great. This was a fantastic discovery. And what it basically led to then was an ability to rewind the clock then. If the universe, it said the only way for this to happen is if the universe is expanding. And I'm going to show a demonstration of this in just a minute as to how this works. But the only way to explain why, if something's twice as far away, it's moving twice as fast away from us. If it's five times farther away, it's moving five times faster away from us. The only way that makes sense is if the universe is expanding. Well, if it's expanding, that means you can rewind the clock. And so that's what they did. We could call that Hubble time. And when he first did this, this is not the correct answer, but for the first time ever, they had an estimate for the age of our universe. The idea that our universe is finite, that it had a beginning. This was all brand new. And if you just take 1 over H naught, which would be time, because this equation, essentially, if you take the H naught and divide it under the other side, it becomes 1 over H naught. Well, that becomes distance equals rate times time. So the 1 over H naught is time. And in this case, he first estimated the universe to be about 15 billion years old. Now, that's not quite right, but at least it's in the ballpark, and it gave astronomers a rough idea. Even in the original Cosmos series, that's the number that Carl Sagan would use in his book and in this TV show. We've more finely tuned that number today. But that was amazing that for the first time ever, they were able to get an estimate for the age of the universe, 15 billion years, and that it had a starting point, a beginning. Now, one of the big mistakes at the time was that assumes distance equals rate times time. You're not including an acceleration. And we know now that the universe has been accelerating for the past few billion years. So we'll talk about that part later. That's one reason it's off. And of course, the distances were probably a little off too. Anyway, if the universe had a beginning, how did it begin? If you rewind the clock, what happens is the universe starts to become denser and denser and denser as you rewind the clock. It's getting smaller in volume, smaller, smaller. All that material is coming closer together. It gets denser in time, where all of the material of the universe is back together. And they called that then the singularity. The singularity. Or at the time, sometimes they used the term primeval atom. This was just absolutely revolutionary. This whole idea that the whole universe could start at a point of almost infinite density like this and spring forth was just, it just sounds crazy, of course. And a lot of scientists didn't believe it at first and kind of fought against it. But ever since then, all of our data shows that that is, that seems to be the case. The point expanded rapidly. Well, yes, it did. We'll get to that later in the chapter as well. But for this to all work just right, there had to be a process called inflation, where there was where the universe literally inflated faster than the speed of light in that first fraction of a second. It gets pretty crazy for this to all work out. But anyway, what we see today in the universe is a result of this explosion, not of galaxies and matter, but the actual explosion of space and time. Let me try to demonstrate this.